I would sure hate to see what Mark Zandi thinks is a recession. If he thinks these are good times, they're not. They're hard times, not only domestically, but for the global economy as well.
Welcome to Global Macro Update. I'm Ed D'Agostino from Mauldin Economics, and this week I'm joined by Dr. Lacy Hunt, Executive Vice President of Hoisington Investment Management, former senior economist to the Dallas Federal Reserve, as well as several of the world's largest financial institutions. Lacy and I discuss the growing cracks in the economy, stress among America's 120 million wage earners, and the U.S. government's massive debt problem. Be sure to stick around to the end for access to Lacy's recommended reading list. Here's Lacy. Lacy, always great to see you. Thanks for joining me. Really appreciate your time.
My pleasure. Always a pleasure to be with you, Ed.
I saw a tweet, Lacy, on Monday, and after I read it, I immediately thought of you and thought, I wonder what Lacy would think about this. This is a tweet from Mark Zandi, the economist from Moody's Analytics, who's a great guy and I think intellectually honest, but I suspect is looking at the economy very differently than you are. So let me just summarize his tweet. He basically said that this is among the best performing economies that he's ever seen in 35 plus years as an economist. And then he lists some things. He said real GDP is up 3% over the past year. Unemployment is near 4%, which is close to full employment. Inflation is coming down to 2%. Household debt is low. Interest rates are coming down. Corporate profits are high. Home equity is high. The stock market is on fire. So he concedes there's a couple of issues, especially if you're in a lower income household, that there's some pressure there and that the government deficits are incredibly high. But then he kind of wraps it up by saying, all in all, the economy has rarely ever looked better. Do you agree?
I would sure hate to see what Mark Zandi thinks is a recession. If he thinks these are good times, they're not. They're hard times, not only domestically, but for the global economy as well. And I think that the national accounts do suggest the economy is growing well, but the national accounts have a major disconnect in the United States. And there's good reason for why they shouldn't be doing well. We've recently constructed a weighted and detrended money supply aggregate for the United States, China, Japan, the EU, and the United Kingdom. And this aggregate over the last 4 years is declining very, very sharply. So when you look at actual M2 growth for the last 4 years versus detrended, we're substantially in negative territory. And what that means is that the economy is far below station what we would call the stationary growth rate, the STR. And it is very substantially negative. And it suggests that the economy is going to experience a sustained period of subpar economic growth and declining inflation. And that's the condition. Now, normally, when you have a severe monetary contraction, the sequence is that, first of all, the money growth comes down, and then you get a deceleration in economic activity. And then you get a deceleration in inflation. That's the pattern. There's virtually hardly any exceptions to that rule. Money leads, GDP is coincident, and the inflation rate is lagging. And that, is, by the way, is the case in the four major foreign economies. Money growth has collapsed. It's brought down economic activity in Japan, China, the EU, and the UK. In the United States, we've had a collapse in monetary growth on the terms of the way in which I measure it. And we've had a dramatic deceleration in inflation, which what I would call a contra-normal cyclical development. You've had the inflation rate come down, without the GDP declining. And that doesn't usually work that way. Now, in economics, quantity effects and price effects both convey knowledge. And when economic conditions are weakening, you expect to see the broad volumetric measures to deteriorate. But when economic activity is weakening, you experience a sharp decline in the inflation rate. Well, the inflation rate has dropped more than it typically does during a recession and immediately after, with the GDP still rising. And I think that what we're witnessing is a very broad and very basic disconnect between the national accounts and many measures of the economy. Take, for example, one of the things that we've always been able to do for this economy is we've had affordable homes and cars for the vast majority of our people. Yet if you look at the vehicle sales, the new home sales, existing home sales, they're all down very substantially from their peaks of the last 5 years. Vehicle sales in the teens, existing and new home sales down in the 35 to 40% range. A very, very broad disconnect.
Yeah. And on top of that, rents really high.
Well, rents are very high. And one of the consequences of high inflation, the inflation rate is dropping, but the inflation rate that ensued from the pandemic, the extraordinary and unwise coordination of monetary and fiscal policy, has left us with a very serious overhang of high prices in the automotive and housing sectors. And so if you look at the real weekly earnings of 120 million salaried and full-time employees, you will see that in the 16 months of this expansion, those folks have experienced a 2% rate of decline. And at the same time, as a consequence of the inflation, you are left with these inordinately high prices for new cars and homes. They're roughly 20% higher than they were prior to the pandemic. And you've left them unaffordable for the vast majority of our people. And so when you say the inflation rate is coming down, it's true, but that's the marginal effect. We're still hung with these inordinately high prices that arose during the pandemic response. And as a matter of fact, although the national income figures have been revised to reflect a much stronger position, if consumers were really in good shape, they would be able to afford the higher cars and the higher home. And they're not. In addition, we're seeing a very sharp increase in the delinquency rate on consumer installment loans and on automobile loans. The critical 90-day rate has just risen to new peak levels. We're back where we were in 2010, 2011. We've seen a substantial increase in bankruptcy rates. The only category that has not experienced rising delinquency rates is the student loans, where they were in some type of deferment, or the folks were in some sort of view that they were going to be either forgiven the loans, but the Supreme Court has choked all of that off. And now here we are in October, and the deferments that were granted during the pandemic have expired. And so the consumer has been spared that burden, but by not having to pay their student loans, it lent a degree of strength to some of the consumer spending areas that would not have occurred, but that stimulus is no longer behind us. And so the consumer is in far worse shape than is generally. One final point.
Sure.
The University of Michigan pioneered consumer surveying. in the 1950s by the late Dr. George Katona. I had the privilege of studying from one of Dr. Katona's students, Dr. Bill Lyons. And I'm very familiar with how the University of Michigan survey is constructed. I believe it's not only has the longest history, but I think that it has the most rigorous economics assumptions and structure. And if you look at where the University of Michigan survey is right now, folks are mighty glum. And in fact, the latest readings from Michigan measuring nationwide are below where we entered all the recessions since the 1950s. And another outstanding survey is from the National Federation of Independent Business, which was constructed by economist William Dunkelberg. And Dunkelberg, who was trained by Katona, knows what he's doing. Survey is well highly regarded. Many people consider small business is where the rubber hits the road.
Absolutely.
And small business is saying the same thing that the consumers are. And one final point. If you look at the latest surveys from the Business Roundtable, which are corporate CEOs, they showed a very sharp decline in sales, hiring, and CapEx plans for the fourth quarter. So the GDP, the national accounts, look strong. They've been revised upward. But the fact of the matter is there are a great many components of the economy which are experiencing very hard times. And the only country in the world that can make claim to a degree of prosperity is the United States, and that is primarily centered in the national accounts, not in other objective measures, important objective measures of well-being.
There's so many things I want to ask you to follow on to that, Lacy, but a couple of things stuck out at me. You talked about homes and cars. And you could probably put food into that category as well, just critical needs of everyone that are hung up at an incredibly high price level. Even with inflation is coming down, it doesn't mean the prices are coming down. Are you arguing that what we need to have happen is actually deflation? Because that comes with a whole other set of potential problems.
Well, we are seeing deflation in the goods sector right now, and very persistent in the big tickets, because they're out of people's price range. And it's going to take a period of adjustment to bring the price levels down into affordable range. And you know, this really isn't surprising. Because I think one of the great lessons of history is that inflation robs everyone, but it robs the modest and moderate income households the most. And there has been severe dislocation. Another problem too, you quoted Mark Zandi on the 4.2% in unemployment rate as being low. That number is very deceiving. First of all, we've had a lot of folks drop out of the labor force because they don't think, and we have a measure of unemployment called U6. And it has risen much more dramatically, and it's at a very high level of 7.8%. And, that's even with the fact that over the last year, the household employment is basically unchanged. But it reflects the fact that full-time employment is nosedive and part-time employment has risen. And that makes people feel miserable. I mean, you know, if you work one job and it satisfies the family needs, you also have spare time. You don't have to hustle from one part-time job to the next. And you also have benefits. Yes. To pretend in the current environment that people are doing well when they're being forced into part-time work because that's all that's available is in my opinion, a very jaundiced view of the reality of the situation.
There's a lot of narratives as to how we got here, Lacy. You mentioned the coordination of fiscal and monetary policy. How do we get out of this? What would you say is the cure? And well, let's start there. What is the cure to this problem that we have?
Well, tremendous mistakes were made. The Federal Reserve is supposed to be independent. They coordinated with fiscal policy. They basically ended the fractional reserve banking system. We no longer have reserve requirements, which they have the power to do, but that was never the intention of the Federal Reserve Act. Another major intention of the Federal Reserve system was that it should be independent. They coordinated with fiscal policy. And then when the inflation rate rose, the fiscal partners were no longer present. In other words, the Fed had to clean the situation up and by themselves. And as a matter of fact, fiscal policy went in the wrong direction. But the Federal Reserve, because ultimately, in my view, it's more powerful than fiscal policy, has brought the inflation rate down. And seemingly, miraculously, because you didn't get the normal sequence where monetary contraction occurs, GDP declines, and then you get the lower inflation, which is, it raises serious question as to the mechanism that we had. And as I said earlier, that mechanism was at work in the other four largest economies of the world. They followed the normal sequence. And so the U.S. economy is in a very precarious situation. And as I said, the 120 million people that we require to carry the heaviest load for us, you know, to get up each day and raise their households and go to work, they have suffered the greatest consequence. You know, you can talk about this upward revision to the national income that occurred in the latest revisions. But if you look at the numbers closely, it was in two categories. It was in transfer payments and interest income. The transfer payments, actually, the level was shifted up during the pandemic. The differential between transfer payments before and after revision has remained remarkably the same since the upward revision during the pandemic. Now, that suggests that was a stimulus then, but it's not a stimulus now. The modest households that were getting it, they've already fully incorporated those funds into the spending stream. The second major category of upward revision was interest income, and it was actually the largest. Well, I can accept that. Interest income should have been revised upward. Interest rates have risen. But here again, the modest and moderate income households have a puny amount of interest income.
Yeah.
So in essence, although this is not contained in the preliminary national accounts, in all likelihood, the upward revision in interest income went to the upper income households, not to the modest and moderate income households.
Sure.
And so while the national accounts look better, that's confined to the top decile of our economy and maybe part of the second decile. In other words, it does not reflect a broad restatement of how the vast majority of the American people are doing. And that's why they're glum. That's why they think we're in hard times. That's why small business thinks we're in hard times.
And that essentially gets to the core of your point, where you say that inflation hurts at a disproportionate level across the economy, right? If you're wealthy or if you have assets, you can invest in ways that benefit from inflation. If you don't have excess assets, then all you have are the costs of inflation. Is that essentially right?
You said it better than I did, Ed.
I'm just a simple guy trying to keep up with one of the greatest economists of my lifetime. So bear with me. So how much of this boils down to government debt and deficits? Because in your last note, in the second quarter Hoisington note, you had a chart where you highlighted debt to GDP at 90%. And we are well above 90%, but that 90% mark seemed to be an important threshold for you.
Mm-hmm.
So how much does government debt play into it?
And that's ultimately the critical question, and that's the one that no one's willing to answer. And that's really the tragedy of the presidential election. By the way, that 90% level is based on gross government debt. And it's not my figure as being a critical level. It was it came from an outstanding econometric study published in one of the American Economic Association's peer-reviewed journals, written by the Reinhardts and Ken Rogoff. And it's called Debt in a Time of Growth in a Time of Debt. And what they showed is that when gross government debt goes above 90% of GDP, you lose one third of your growth rate against trend. And now we're at 120%. So basically, historically, from 1870 to 1970, we grew at about 2.3% per annum. We're now growing at about 1.4% per annum. So we've lost 0.9% on a 2.3% base. That's about 40% of our growth trend. Reinhardt and Rogoff said that we would lose a third of our growth rate against trend. And that's going to happen. And here we are in a presidential campaign, and there's no attention being paid to the government debt. In fact, all I'm seeing are more and more promises.
From both sides. Yeah.
Debt levels are going to continue to rise. There's a corroborating study that proved equally as prescient as Reinhardt and Rogoff, a book published in 2000 by two outstanding Swedish economists, Berg and Henriksson. They teach at Scandinavian universities today, but part of their career was at Harvard. Their work is first rate. And they did it a little differently. What they looked at was the impact on the real per capita growth rate of what happens when the share of government economic activity increases. And what they found is that for each 1 percentage point increase in the government share of economic activity, you lose about 0.9, you lose 0.09% of growth per annum. So in 1970, the government share of economic activity was 25% of GDP. Today, it's 36% of GDP. And so we've lost about 1%, as I said, same number that Reinhardt and Rogoff would have projected. You go deeper and deeper into the government sector, and you get less economic performance. And there's a third way of confirming that, because what happened is that when the Fed reversed monetary policy after the inflation rate surged dramatically, the federal budget deficit was funded entirely by the domestic non-bank financial sector. And that meant that the funds were not available for the private sector. You know, a lot of people are talking about the revisions to the national accounts. I gave you my analysis of it. But all the news wasn't good. There was some very disturbing news. Because of the fact that home sales have been lackluster and motor vehicle sales have been lackluster, we're seeing a big buildup in inventories. We have... Mm-hmm. Automobile inventories and units back at where they were in 2019, even though the selling rate is down 12 to 14%. The home sales are down 35 to 40% from their peak levels. But yet we've seen a substantial increase in recent months to 9 or 10 month high in unsold home inventories. And if you look at the upward, if you look at the GDP accounts for the first half of the year, what you see is that the inventory buildup was not just confined to automobiles and houses. It was far broader. And if you do this little exercise, if you take the real GDP and you exclude the inventories, the growth rate in the economy was under 2% in the first half of the year. So there was actually a slowdown, but it was masked by this buildup in inventories, which is not sustainable.
So the fix for this, Lacy, right? We have a few options, right? If we have to get the government's debt load down.
We do, and we can't do it. And there's no one proposing it. And so so what you do is each level of government spending, you get a transitory boost to economic activity. Mm-hmm. But this multiplier plays out, and by the end of 3 years, the government expenditure multiplier is negative. And for the 3 year period, the multiplier is minus 0.3%. So what that means, if you borrow a dollar to engage in increased government activity, at the end of the year, you've got the dollar you borrowed, but you're going to reduce private saving by 30 cents, which means that the net economy is only going to expand 70 cents. And this is a reflection of the law of diminishing returns. If you overuse the factor of production, initially you will boost GDP. You continue to boost that factor of production, such as debt capital. The GDP flattens out. You still overuse it, the GDP turns down. It's a nonlinear relationship. It's a parabola.
Okay.
And so what's basically been happening since we went on this high debt path, each dollar of government debt was historically generating about twice as much of GDP than it is today. And so we're basically on the wrong path. You can satisfy individual constituencies. You can make them happier. But the fact of the matter is the end result is weaker. And that's what Reinhardt and Rogoff have demonstrated. And that's what Hendrickson and Berg have demonstrated.
You said that we can't address this.
No.
You can increase tax receipts, which no one is excited about. You can cut government spending, or we can grow the economy, or I guess we could debase the dollar. Are those sort of the four options in front of us?
You could reduce the dollar, but our exports are determined by foreign income and price levels. The income effects are five times more powerful than the price effects. And so if you reduce the dollar, there would be some shift in goods production to the United States. However, the rest of the world is not in a position to give up that production, because they are all in hard times. And so you would get some transitory benefit from depreciating the dollar, but then you make the rest of the world sicker. And then the second round effect is to feed back to the United States, and you wouldn't be any better off.
Okay.
Now you say, well, the consumer can't have higher taxes, but we could tax the corporate sector. And there is that proposal out there to raise corporate taxes, very substantially. According to analysis that I saw from Piper Sandler, if we were to carry forward with that proposal, you'd make U.S. corporate taxes the second highest in the world. Only Colombia is higher. But if you raise corporate taxes, that's equivalent to an increase in corporate costs.
Sure.
Well, so you reduce the bottom line of the corporate sector. They have to raise prices. If the Fed's monetary policy doesn't make that permissible, then corporate capital is mobile. If their returns go down here in the United States because of higher corporate taxes, and they can't push them through, the corporations will move.
Mm-hmm.
Well, if you move capital, then you're going to get less jobs. So the fact of the matter is that some of the partial solutions that are being recommended on both sides of the aisle have only very limited transitory benefits while making the U.S. and the rest of the world more unstable. In other words, the political debate that we're having is not really addressing the issues that the country's facing. Very bad situation, in my opinion.
How much do you think technology...
Now I've made both the Democrats and Republicans mad at me.
I consider that a win, because maybe they'll at least start listening.
Thank you. I appreciate it. A lot of people don't.
Does productivity factor into this, Lacy? I mean, if we can employ technology, and I'm thinking about AI and automation, just as a couple of examples, if we can employ those technologies to really boost productivity, does that offset some of this bad situation that we're in?
Well, conceivably it could, but that may be a long-term process. And I have a contrary piece of evidence here. One of the things that I do to sort of check the GDP numbers is I look at electric power production. Now, you know, Ed, mm-hmm. and I'm sure our viewers know, that these data centers should be requiring a lot of electric power, right?
Uh-huh.
That's been discussed. And people are asking where the electric power. So we know we've got a boom in construction of data centers.
Right.
Which should boost electric power production. And if the GDP is doing what it should, historically, electric power production rises at the same rate as the GDP. In other words, if you get a 1% gain in GDP, you get a 1% gain in electric power. But we should be getting better because of all the emphasis on the data centers and the electricity that they consume. Yet in the latest 12 months, electric power production is only up 0.5%.
Wow, interesting.
Major disconnect. In other words, if the boom in data centers is really there, why is it not showing in electric power production? In fact, the electric power production is casting aspersions on the validity of the GDP.
That's interesting because this week, as we speak, it was announced that a second retired mothballed nuclear power plant was going to be brought back online, which takes years, right? But that is starting to happen. That's becoming a thing, bringing old mothballed nuclear plants, upgrading them and bringing them back online. And the argument is data centers, right? I think Three Mile Island's being brought back online, and Microsoft is already pre-committed to buying all of its electricity.
But that's built on the assumption that this boom will take place. And
right.
And as of so far, right now, we don't observe that.
You're not seeing it. Interesting.
No. So.
So I've heard you say.
Also, another thing to keep in mind is that a lot of these assumptions are based upon the forecast that we're going to be mothballing fossil fuels and moving into green energy. Well, it's not said that this is a consideration, but it's possible that some of the motivation may think that the mothballing of fossil fuels is going to impair the production of electric power. And, you know, this isn't some sort of pipe dream. One of the things that really hurt Germany,
mm-hmm.
and Germany is a very, very sick economy. It's been the historic leader of Germany. They've just downgraded the forecast to zero from the year. Previously, they had an insignificant gain.
Wow.
And the price level is very weak in Germany. One of the things that happened there is that the Green Movement came into Germany and they started shutting the fossil fuel plants in anticipation the green energy would come in. Well, the fossil fuels are the low cost of production. The green energy is high cost of production. And so Germany shifted to the green energy at a time that it was more costly and the cost could not be passed on. And so it greatly and adversely affected the German economy. And I think that that's an important lesson for us all. If the great German economy cannot sustain such a shift, how is the U.S. economy going to sustain such a shift? So the fact of the matter is, all we know right now is that the impacts that people are factoring in for the future are not yet visible, which suggests the process is moving slower than people believe that it is.
You've said many times that demographics is destiny.
Auguste Comte, the great French philosopher, was the first to say that. Many people forget Comte, but he was an empiricist. You know, he lived in the late 1800s, very smart fellow. And he said, you look at the age, the composition, the distribution of the employment. It's very important. And I don't think it's changed. I'm sorry I interrupted you.
No, not at all. I wanted to see where you would go with it because, you know, I'm trying to find a happy ending and there isn't one, I don't think, Lacy. But you know, you look at other Western countries or advanced countries. I don't know if you could put Japan in the West, but I Japan comes to mind as a country that's farther ahead of us in terms of average age of the population. And they've had decades.
Oh, the average age in Japan, according to my figures, are 48. We're 38 in the U.S. 10 years for a country's average age is huge difference. Massive. By the way, the average age now in China is 41, and every 2 years that go by, we add 1 year to the average age in China. And there's a huge mismatch between young men and young women. The economic performance is poor, so that when a young woman finally takes a suitor and they've got multiple choices, they don't have confidence to have children right away. And so you've got a record low birth rate in China, just as we do in the United States. And so there's an interaction between the economy and the demographics. Another issue with regard to demographics, Milton Friedman was a very wise man, Nobel laureate. I learned a lot from him in many, many ways. Great believer in free market economics, monetary economics. But he studied demographics very carefully. And what he said was that legal immigration, when people came here for economic opportunity, economies received a benefit. That's been demonstrated time and time again. The problem is that today we no longer have legal immigration. We're bringing in immigrants illegally and at a dramatically faster rate. And it's not like the old days when government benefits were relatively limited. We have people that will, the age composition is more skewed, not just all young people. And we're going to owe for Social Security, Medicare, Obamacare, Medicaid, whole host of our government programs. And this is going to explode the governmental cost at a time when the government debt to GDP ratio is 120% of GDP. It's above the deleterious impact point. And another issue that seems to be an issue, which Friedman never really considered to be a problem, And that is when you have illegal immigration, whether you are picking up a nefarious component of illegal activity. And so we have high immigration, but it comes at a time when we're over indebted and we're allowing people to come in who can tap these programs, which are all inadequately funded, Social Security, Medicare, Obamacare. And so the country has really grave issues, and basic programs may ultimately become in jeopardy. And of course, some people say, well, we can always print our way out, which is what we did during the pandemic. But the fact of the matter is, very few people can be prosperous in a high inflationary environment. Mm-hmm. A few will do well, but the vast majority will not do well. And so we have very substantial issues. And in my opinion, if Friedman were here today, he would say that the immigration is not of the sort that has typically been so beneficial to economic growth.
So, Lacy, this makes me think of the most unlikely partnership in modern political history, the partnership of Newt Gingrich and Bill Clinton, who managed to get the deficit under control. Yeah. And they got excess spending under control and brought debt down. Is it too far gone? Is that not a possibility?
That's one of the very sad things. Historically, we've had an ability of our two major parties to compromise differences. For example, during the 1950s, the budget was balanced. And you had Eisenhower, Republican. You had Sam Rayburn and Lyndon Johnson running the Democrats. We did things for the national interest. We started the interstate highway program. We funded it by a nickel tax increase. It was designed as desirable. We were able to compromise differences and move forward. There was also a great partnership between the Federal Reserve and a respect of dealing with the administration. You had William McChesney Martin, who was a Democrat. Eisenhower was a Republican. Partisan politics never entered the picture. Partisan politics brought the Fed to a serious mistake in the early 1970s when Burns, who was an appointee of Nixon, cooperated with funding the Nixon's reelection effort in 1972 in the midst of wage and price controls. Mm-hmm. Then in the 1980s, before Clinton and Newt Gingrich compromised, you had Reagan, a Republican, and you had Tip O'Neill. They didn't have the same agendas, but they were able to compromise. And we saw this same type of situation, which you so wisely mentioned, between Gingrich and Clinton. But I don't see that as a possibility under the current environment. The rhetoric is so harsh. The reason there's such a frenetic effort here in the elections that both parties are trying to gain control so that they can force their agenda on the other party.
Yeah.
And if you look at the actions that have been taken since Gingrich and Clinton, we've had government policies in which one party has rammed its programs over the other party. And that doesn't usually work. And so the spirit of goodwill and conciliation and partisanship that has historically served us well since the 1950s seems to no longer be present, Ed. Sadly so.
Yeah. Yeah, they don't need to agree, but they do need to talk.
They do. And they have to find a way to compromise on their agenda. And it makes it very difficult for the rest of us.
Lacy, I'm giving up. I don't think I can find a happy ending to this story, but I can say it is always highly educational and extremely pleasant to speak with you, sir.
Well, I appreciate that. You know, this is the 55th year of my career.
Yeah, really incredible.
I don't know. Sometimes I think back upon it. You know, when I started at the Dallas Fed in 1969 with my brand new PhD from Temple University, William McChesney Martin was head of the Fed. And I think I'm probably the last of the Federal Reserve economists that's still professionally active from the days of Martin. Wow. When I left the Fed, Arthur Burns was chairman. I didn't know Martin, but I did know Burns. The greatest of our Federal Reserve chairmen was Paul Volcker. He and I became friends in 1970.
Great man.
And I don't really see any Paul Volckers on the scene anymore. I'd like to think they're out there, but hopefully we can reestablish a higher quality of government servants and return to bipartisanship, because the country badly needs it.
I couldn't agree more. Couldn't agree more.
Well, thank you, Ed, for having me on. Always a pleasure.
I hope your wish comes true.
I never know which way you're going to take me, Ed.
Well, you know, I see you're on other podcasts, and I always pay attention. And so part of what I try to do is go a little bit different direction, you know, because what you have to say and the depth and breadth of knowledge is unrivaled. And I think that it's, I just see it as my job to help people see how impressive your thoughts are and how important it is to not just listen to the mainstream narrative.
Well, thank you. I don't know. You know, I prepared a little document of recommended readings with my version of Cliff Notes. And I don't know whether anyone would be interested in it, but
absolutely.
If you want, I'll send it to you and you can make it available.
I would greatly appreciate that. And I'm sure our viewers and readers would as well. Please do.
Okay. I'll be glad to send it to you.
Thank you, Lacy. Lacy was kind enough to send me a PDF of his recommended reading list. So these are the documents that Lacy says are essential in economics and investing. There's a link to his PDF in our description below this video. If you enjoyed the conversation, please subscribe to our channel, give us a like, and leave us a comment below. It really helps us out a lot. And by the way, I do read every single comment, and I appreciate your support of this channel. I'm Ed D'Agostino. Thanks for watching.